No matter where you live in the world, you'll likely be told about how the United States received and assimilated immigrants in our history. And you'll be told, given that history, your country should be accepting immigrants today with open arms, because it's going to work out in the same way. Now, most people have some idea of how immigration and assimilation worked in the United States. And if you were to ask them, they'd tell you a story, something like, well, you'd have a wave of immigrants. People from around the world wanted to be part of America. They believed in the founding values. They wanted freedom and liberty and all men created equal, that stuff. And, you know, maybe, for example, they'd mention, okay, in the mid-1800s, a bunch of Germans would immigrate to the United States. Or they'd mention a bunch of Italians immigrating around the turn of the century, 1890s to 1910s. Now, this wave of new people would come in, and when the wave would come in, there'd be an anti-immigrant sentiment that would pop up, and everyone would have their xenophobic moment, but in time, it wouldn't matter because the new group would become American. They would assimilate, and everyone would be fine again until a new wave of people came in, and then we'd repeat the cycle. We'd have some pointless xenophobia, followed by assimilation and acceptance, until a new wave of people showed up. Right? So that's the generic story of American immigration that you might hear. And when Europeans are told this story, it becomes the justification for mass immigration into their countries from the third world. The idea is immigration worked out super well for the United States, or at least that's what they say, so it's going to work out the same for you. Don't worry about it. But let me paint you a different picture here, maybe a different perspective on how immigration to the United States worked. Between 1850 and 1913, nearly all immigrants who came to the United States were from Europe. About a third of them went back to Europe. That's right, a lot of them did not stay. A lot of them didn't find here what they wanted. Now consider this. Immigration to the United States has been historically fairly high. When our economy got bad, especially during the Great Depression, immigration rates tanked. Maybe the reason that immigrants came here was mostly economic reasons, not some sort of belief in Americanism, but economics. Now this is important. Remember, most immigrants are really economic immigrants. We'll get back to that later. Now, here's something else to think about. If you go to Europe, you can go to Northern Europe, historically Protestant, Southern Europe, more historically Catholic. You can go from East to West, and you'll find a very colorful, diverse people across Europe. They can really be quite different from each other. Europeans are not all the same. Italians are wonderful. Swedes are wonderful. But Italians and Swedes are different, different languages, different history, different culture. If all the Italians and all the Swedes were forced onto an island together, you might have some conflict between the Italians and the Swedes. Finland should be full of Finnish people. Greece should be full of Greeks. Europeans, though, are not one homogeneous group. Now, the United States was founded by white people, Europeans, specifically from sort of the northwestern region of Europe. Northwestern Protestants, mostly from Britain, but also Ireland, Germany, Netherlands, and France did have some presence. So that's kind of what the country looked like around 1790 when we were officially a country, just post-colonial. Now, you might imagine if you were to look at Britain in 1790 and America in 1790, there'd be really a lot in common. Tons of shared ancestry, shared language, a lot of manners and customs would be the same. It would be culturally very similar. So if we represented 1790s American culture as a circle, right? We can kind of give the circle fuzzy edges because that's how culture is. But we also gave English culture a circle, they would have a lot of overlap. They'd be really a lot similar. Most people who would be comfortable in America would likely be comfortable in England. But we're not exactly the same, even back then. There are some ways America and England would be a little bit different. And for some people, those could be a deal breaker. For some people, they would be happy in one country, but not the other. So if instead of England, though, we compared America to Germany in 1790, we'd still probably have a good chunk of overlap, but it might be a little bit less overlap than England. So you had all these Europeans historically coming to America for economic reasons, and when they got here, some of them had a hard time fitting in, networking, finding a place for themselves, and being successful. About one-third of them went back to Europe. Now, I'm going to represent immigrants as just a bar here. So you will find some people who are compatible, they'll fit in decently well, and some people are really sort of on the outside of American culture. They aren't within what we would normally do. Now, the one-third of Europeans who went back to Europe, do you think that they were likely on the outside? Yeah, they didn't quite fit in. Like I said, Europe has a lot of diversity in it. The North is not the same as the South, the East not the same as the West. All the European peoples are amazing, but if you took everyone from Ukraine and pushed them into Spain, you'd have big conflicts. But there is less difference between some countries than others, right? There's maybe less difference between Iceland and Norway than Iceland and Italy. And the more different you are, the fewer people that will be able to move between those places with minimal conflict. And we see this with Italian immigrants. Remember, America, mostly Northwestern European, Protestant, well, Italians, Southern European, more Catholic, not one-third of them went back to Italy, but over half. Most Italian immigrants who came here left before 1920. That's right, most of them didn't quite fit in. So if you are an American with Italian blood, you're descended likely from one of the families that kind of liked it here. They didn't sit around wishing that they were back home in Italy because, well, the families that wish they were back home in Italy probably ended back home in Italy. You would be there, not here. So this is where the anti-immigrant sentiment comes in. America, at times, would get a big flood of immigrants, and often America and Americans would point out that some of these immigrants don't fit in. They prefer their old country, they prefer their old ways, they prefer their old languages, and some of that conflicts with the American way. So there was pressure on immigrant groups, shaming, shunning, telling them that they either need to shape up or ship out, as in be like us or get back on the boat. Now, this process of telling immigrants they need to either get with us or get out, that's an important process because it did help force some of the people who didn't fit in to leave. Without this heavy pressure to fit in to the American way, many of them would have maybe stayed. Because remember, they were here for economic reasons, not ideological reasons. So instead of this myth where over time people become something new, what actually happened is the people who didn't fit in went back home. Now, partly this is because we were so hard on them. But think about it. People, to a large degree, they just are who they are. They have a sense of integrity, virtue, honesty. All these things that they think are really done in physical constructs in the brain. If you were to move to an area where everyone judged things differently than the way that you do, but they all agreed with each other, you might not be able to just choose to start seeing the world differently, choose to find certain things lovely and certain things disgusting. You either live under their way and the way they see things, or you move out and you go to a place where people are like you. So you might hear someone say something like, those xenophobic episodes in America's past didn't do anything. But those anti-immigrant movements were really large. They were huge. They had a big effect on the immigrants, especially the ones who thought that they weren't quite fitting in and were struggling. The notion that our nation would be the same without these large movements is really naive. Now here's the thing. White Americans used to be able to rail on and complain about some of the European immigrants who kind of didn't fit in. But now we have a problem. Now our immigrants aren't white. We're not allowed to criticize them anymore. It would be racist. Ooh, that's a word that people use to shut up white people. Now, here's something to think about. If a third of Europeans who came to America left, and even when you just go down to Southern Europe, Italy, already more than half of immigrants are going back home, what percentage of people would you expect to stay from a non-European, non-Christian culture, who's even more different from us than Italy? How about Muslims from Africa or shamanistic Mongolian people? What percentage of them would really fit in America when less than half of Italians fit in? Maybe 10% of them, or 5%, or 2%? Now, I don't know what the answer is. I can tell you it's likely a very small number, single digit, possibly less than 1%. But imagine if American people were so harsh on Middle Eastern immigrants or African immigrants that 95% of them went back home, we would be called racist and it wouldn't be tolerated. They'd make a big deal out of that. Now, from what I've seen online, you have a similar situation in the UK. There's some immigration from Eastern Europe, which is bothering some Brits, and there's some Middle Eastern immigration, which is bothering some Brits. And at least in the past, as far as I could tell, the Brits have generally had a little bit more freedom to criticize immigration from Eastern Europe than the Middle East, because at least those are white Europeans, often Christians, so you're kind of allowed to criticize them. But I think people are cracking down on that double standard. I think Brits who are criticizing Eastern Europeans are getting a little bit more flack than they used to. But there is something very important here. This mechanism of putting pressure on economic immigrants is critical because it's this pressure that pushes economic immigrants who don't fit in to go back home. When you take away the ability to put pressure on immigrants, you end up with large groups of people in your country who don't like your country, and they don't like the culture, and they don't like the other people there. This is planting the seeds of conflict. And because we're not allowed to be harsh on these non-white groups when we were allowed to be harsh to other Europeans, we end up in a real problem, especially since many of these non-white groups are even more different from us. So really, we should be harsher, not less harsh. But not only are we not being harsh on them, we're doing the opposite. Many of these groups get financial assistance. The Somalians in Minnesota are often getting checks and government assistance to help them. The Swedish great-great-grandpa of you or your friend, when he went to Minnesota from Sweden, he was told he needed to shape up or ship out, get a job and support a family like the rest of America. So if you get a bunch of immigrants and assimilation doesn't happen, which is very common today, you end up with some awkward stuff. You end up with multiculturalism. For example, in cities like London or Minneapolis, you can end up with Muslim populations that don't fully engage in your society. If there's a significant conflict within their community, they might not call the police because they enforce rules within the community. They use fathers and uncles and brothers, and instead of going to a court, they might hold their own sort of court where the judges are the elders of their community or religious leaders like an imam. Now, here's the thing. If you have different police in different courts, you're going to have different laws. There are 5 metropolitan areas in the United States that have high concentrations of FGM, female circumcision, right? Female genital mutilation. It's done to baby girls. New York City, Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, Seattle, and Minneapolis. And it's pretty much all done illegally. Now, some people are upset about this. Maybe they don't want baby girls being mutilated, but that's the norm where these people came from. And when they came to this country, there was no assimilation. They kept their old norms, and they don't want new norms. Now, if you wanted to force them to start using the normal courts and the normal law enforcement, you'd have a lot of friction because they don't agree with the laws that those systems are in. This is multiculturalism manifest. Different standards of behavior existing in the same space, and that creates conflict. I have a video on multiculturalism for that. As sort of a side note, you'll hear all the time, people will lament on how monolingual America is. Many people in Germany or Belgium might speak at least a little of 2 or more languages, but in America, we only speak English. But something to keep in mind is many of us in the United States had parents, grandparents, great-grandparents who came from a European country who did speak a different language. But here's the deal. The European migrants who liked the old language and liked the old ways and liked the old countries a lot of times went back to Europe. Many of our grandparents refused to teach their children the old language from Europe. They insisted, under pressure, that they loved America and they wanted their children to be American, which means they only ever learned English. So here's something to think about. People in your country who aren't speaking your language, people in your country who teach their children their old language, probably don't belong in your country. This is one of the most obvious signs of division. Not only is it a sign, language genuinely divides people. It prevents more effective communication. So if someone in your country has immigrated and is teaching their children the old language, it is strong evidence that they're not fitting in and don't belong there. You cannot expect some Middle Easterner to assimilate into England while they teach their kid Arabic in the same way that Germans assimilated into America, because a lot of the Germans who stayed here refused to teach their kid German. In summary, economic migrants must be treated harshly so you can weed out the ones who don't really belong. Economic immigrants can't be given economic incentives to stay even when they don't belong. And economic immigrants who are teaching their children the customs and the language of their old country are sowing the seeds of division. There will be no assimilation. So no, third world immigrants to Europe, to the United States, to Australia, to Canada, they will not be anything like the past European waves of migration to the United States. Advocating for mass third world immigration into white countries isn't done based on a reasonable understanding of history. It's done with a hatred in their heart of white people and a desire to replace us in our own countries.